Hi everyone, I'm Dr. Babita, and in today's video, we will discuss the anatomy of extraocular muscles, including their origin, insertion, nerve supply, and blood supply. So what are the various extraocular muscles that are present in our eye? Each eye contains four rectus muscles, the medial rectus, lateral rectus, superior rectus, and inferior rectus, two oblique muscles, superior oblique and inferior oblique, and one muscle of the eyelid, which is the levator palpebrae superioris muscle. Levator palpebrae superioris is mainly concerned with the elevation of the upper eyelid, and I have already discussed it in detail in my video on the anatomy of the eyelid. So in this video, we will restrict ourselves to the other six extraocular muscles that are responsible for the movement of the eye. We will discuss the rectus muscles first. In Latin, the word rectus means straight, and the plural of rectus is recti. So these muscles have a straight course from their origin to their insertion. They run along a straight route. All four rectus muscles arise from the annulus of Zinn, which is located at the superior orbital fissure. Superior orbital fissure is a foramen in the skull that lies between the lesser and the greater wings of sphenoid. So this is the superior orbital fissure of the right orbit. Adjacent to it, you can see the optic canal from where the optic nerve enters the orbit, and this is where the annulus of Zinn is located. It is a ring of fibrous tissue that is located at the apex of the orbit. Orbital apex is the most posterior part of the orbit where all the four walls of the orbit seem to converge. Annulus means a ring. So annulus of Zinn is also known as the common tendinous ring. If we draw a diagram of this area, we can see that the annulus of Zinn divides the superior orbital fissure into three parts. And the optic canal containing the optic nerve and ophthalmic artery also lies within the boundaries of the annulus of Zinn. About the other contents of superior orbital fissure, we will discuss them when we will discuss the nerve supply of the extraocular muscles. So the four recti arise from the annulus of Zinn. As their names imply, superior rectus arises from the superior part of the ring, medial rectus from the medial part, inferior rectus from the inferior part, and lateral rectus from the lateral part of the ring. All four recti then travel anteriorly and they get inserted on the sclera. Superior rectus gets inserted on the superior sclera. You can see three diagrams here from three different perspectives. First is when you are viewing the eye from the front, you can see the superior rectus getting inserted above the superior limbus at a certain distance from it. The second diagram is as viewed from the medial side of the eye, and the third diagram represents the view when the eye is seen from above. Inferior rectus gets inserted on the inferior sclera. The third diagram is when you see the eye from below. Medial rectus gets inserted on the nasal sclera, and lateral rectus gets inserted on the temporal sclera. All the four recti are approximately 40 mm long, and they all insert into the sclera by tendinous insertions. These grey areas represent the muscle tendons. Medial rectus inserts 5.5 mm away from the limbus. Limbus is the junction between the cornea and the sclera. Inferior rectus inserts 6.5 mm away from the limbus. Lateral rectus inserts 6.9 mm away from the limbus. And the superior rectus inserts 7.7 mm away from the limbus. So starting from the medial rectus and going clockwise, the insertions of the rectus muscles are 5.5, 6.5, 6.9 and 7.7 mm away from the limbus. Of all the recti, medial rectus has the shortest tendon, which is only about 4.5 mm long. Though overall, of all the six extraocular muscles, inferior oblique has the shortest tendon, which is only 1 mm long, and we will learn about it in a while. The width of recti at their insertion is 10 mm, that is 1 cm on an average. Lateral rectus is 10.1 mm wide, superior rectus is 11.5 mm wide, inferior rectus width is 10.5 mm and medial rectus width is 11.3 mm. These are all average values, they vary widely from case to case. The distance between the rectus insertions varies from an average of 5.9 mm between the medial rectus and the inferior rectus, to 8 mm between the inferior rectus to the lateral rectus. The distance between lateral rectus and superior rectus is 7.1 mm and that between superior rectus and medial rectus is 7.5 mm. If we connect these insertions, we get what we call the spiral of Deloks. So spiral of Tulox is an imaginary line that connects the insertions of all the four rectus muscles. Also, it is important to note that the sclera is the thinnest at the site of rectus muscle insertions. The thickness of sclera at the site of rectus muscle insertions is only 0.3 mm, and that makes this site a very common site of scleral rupture in cases of ocular trauma. Coming to the obliques, each eye contains two oblique muscles, the superior oblique and the inferior oblique. The oblique muscles do not arise from the annulus of Zinn. The superior oblique muscle arises from the body of the sphenoid, so from here, and then it travels anteriorly to reach the trochlea. Trochlea, which means a pulley, is a cartilaginous structure which is attached to the periosteum of the frontal bone in the supranasal quadrant of the orbit at the trochlear fossa. So this is the frontal bone, this is the supranasal part of the orbit, and this is where the trochlear fossa is located, and trochlea is attached at the trochlear fossa. The superior oblique muscle changes its direction at the trochlea. So before reaching the trochlea, it was traveling forwards towards the anterior part of the orbit, and then it takes a turn at the trochlea and starts traveling in the posterolateral direction. So like this. It is traveling in the backward direction and it is also traveling laterally. Along its course, it passes beneath the superior rectus muscle and then it finally inserts into the sclera. What is very important to know is that although the anatomical origin of the superior oblique muscle is the body of the sphenoid at the orbital apex, its functional origin is considered to be the trochlea because all of its actions are along this axis, that is after it has changed its direction at the trochlea. Of all the extraocular muscles, superior oblique has the longest tendon at about 26 mm. The average width of insertion is 11 mm and the anterior end of superior oblique insertion is 4.5 mm posterior to the temporal end of superior rectus insertion. So this distance is 4.5 mm approximately. Again, these values are very variable. Also, here the superior oblique is connected to the superior rectus by intermuscular septum. Coming to the inferior oblique arises from the area adjacent to the lacrimal fossa on the medial side of the orbital floor. So this part here is from where the inferior oblique originates. As you can see that all the other extraocular muscles of the eye arise from the posterior part of the orbit, that is at the orbital apex. But inferior oblique is the only muscle that arises from the anterior part of the orbit. From its origin, the inferior oblique muscle travels posteriorly and laterally along the orbital floor, crosses the inferior rectus muscle, and inserts temporal to the insertion of the lateral rectus. Inferior oblique is the shortest of all extraocular muscles at 37 mm long. Also, of all the extraocular muscles, it has the shortest tendon, which is only about 1 mm long. The border of inferior oblique at its insertion is about 9.5 mm temporal to the inferior border of lateral rectus insertion. It is extremely important to know that this insertion of inferior oblique overlies the macula, which is the most important part of the eye responsible for central vision and visual acuity. That is why during any surgical procedure involving the inferior oblique muscle, one should take care so as not to pull on the muscle excessively. Also, any cautery over this area should be avoided. Another important thing to note is that the pupillomotor preganglionic parasympathetic fibers that innervate the sphincter pupillae muscle of the iris, they lie very close to the inferior oblique at the point where it crosses the inferior rectus muscle. These fibers are responsible for pupillary constriction. Therefore, over-enthusiastic surgical exploration in this area can injure them and result in a dilated pupil. Inferior oblique is connected to lateral rectus by the intermuscular septum. It is also connected to the inferior rectus at the Lockwood ligament. You can learn about Lockwood ligament in detail in my video on eyelid anatomy. So if we look at the diagram here depicting all the six extraocular muscles of the eye, we can see that the superior rectus is connected to the superior oblique, the inferior rectus is connected to the inferior oblique, and lateral rectus is also connected to the inferior oblique by connective tissue septae. The only rectus muscle that does not have any oblique muscle running close to it is the medial rectus muscle. Therefore, during surgeries on medial rectus muscle, if suppose our suture breaks or if the muscle is very tight and contractured and the muscle snaps when we try to hook it, then the muscle goes back into the orbit. We don't get any chance to retrieve the muscle because it does not have any attachments to any other muscle that might catch it. While if you lose your hold on any other rectus muscle, you will be able to retrieve it because its attachments with other muscles will prevent it from retracting back into the orbit. For example, suppose you are doing lateral rectus muscle surgery and by chance you lose hold of the muscle. In that case, you don't need to worry because you will find the muscle at this point where it has connections with the inferior oblique. Medial rectus unfortunately does not have any such connections. Coming to the nerve supply of extraocular muscles, the nerve supply of extraocular muscles comes from three cranial nerves. Lateral rectus is supplied by the sixth cranial nerve, which is the abducens nerve. Superior oblique is supplied by the fourth cranial nerve, which is the trochlear nerve. Cranial nerve third, which is the oculomotor nerve, supplies superior rectus, inferior rectus, medial rectus, and inferior oblique. A popular mnemonic to remember the nerve supply of extraocular muscles is LR6SO4R3, which means that LR, that is the lateral rectus, is supplied by the sixth cranial nerve, SO is supplied by the fourth cranial nerve, and R means remaining, they are supplied by the third cranial nerve. The third cranial nerve has two divisions, superior and inferior. The superior division supplies the superior rectus and also the levator palpebris superioris muscle, while the inferior division supplies the other three muscles, medial rectus, inferior rectus, and inferior oblique. The way to remember it is that superior division supplies the superiors, so superior rectus and levator palpebris superioris, the rest are supplied by the inferior division. If we look at the structures passing through the superior orbital fissure, we can see that the optic nerve, oculomotor nerve, and abducens nerve, they all pass through the annulus of Zinn, while the trochlear nerve is present just outside the annulus of Zinn. So trochlear nerve supplies the superior oblique muscle from outside the muscle cone, while all the other extraocular muscles, they get innervated from the inside of the muscle cone. This is the reason why in retrobulbar blocks, trochlear nerve might escape the effect of anesthesia because retrobulbar block is an intraconal block. Our needle enters inside the muscle cone and then we inject lignocaine. Since trochlear nerve lies outside this cone, it may escape anesthesia in retrobulbar blocks. Also, we can see that optic nerve which enters the eye through the optic canal, it lies very close to the medial portion of the annulus of Zinn. Many patients who have optic neuritis, they complain of pain during extraocular movements, especially during adduction. Because in this area, the inflammation of the optic nerve sheath can spread and involve the sheath of the medial rectus muscle because they lie so close to each other. Coming to the blood supply of extraocular muscles, the arterial supply of extraocular muscles comes from the muscular branches of ophthalmic artery. The two branches are the inferior muscular branch and the superior muscular branch. The inferior muscular branch supplies the medial rectus, inferior oblique, and inferior rectus. The superior muscular branch supplies the lateral rectus, superior oblique, and the LPS. In some texts, superior muscular branch is also called the lateral muscular branch, and inferior muscular branch is called the medial muscular branch. So don't get confused with the names. The lateral rectus also receives its blood supply from the lacrimal artery, while inferior oblique and inferior rectus muscles, they receive partial blood supply from the infraorbital artery, which is a branch of the maxillary artery which arises from the external carotid artery. Venous drainage of the extraocular muscles goes into the superior and the inferior ophthalmic veins. So these muscular branches give rise to anterior ciliary arteries which are carried by the recti to supply the anterior segment of the eye. The superior rectus, inferior rectus, and medial rectus muscles carry two anterior ciliary arteries each, while the lateral rectus carries one anterior ciliary artery. The oblique muscles do not carry any anterior ciliary arteries. The anterior segment of the eye is supplied by three arterial systems, these anterior ciliary arteries, the long posterior ciliary arteries, and the conjunctival vessels. The contribution of anterior ciliary arteries to anterior segment circulation is about 50%, which means that almost half of the blood supply to the anterior segment of the eye comes from these anterior ciliary arteries. The reason why this is important to know is because disinsertion of a rectus muscle during squint surgery can cause hypoperfusion of the area that is supplied by that particular artery. And to maintain optimum anterior segment circulation, it is advised that during squint surgery, in one sitting, more than two rectus muscles of one eye should never be operated upon together, otherwise it might disturb the blood supply of the anterior segment and cause a condition known as anterior segment ischemia. Of course, you can operate two recti plus an oblique because obliques don't contribute to anterior segment circulation. It is seen that the hypoperfusion caused by squint surgeries is eventually compensated by the establishment of collateral circulation. This may take up to 1 to 3 months, but this disruption of anterior ciliary arteries is permanent and their supply is never re-established. So in case you want to operate 3 rectus muscles, you can either operate 2 recti of one eye and 1 rectus muscle of the opposite eye, or you can opt for a vessel sparing procedure like muscle plication. But that is a separate topic and we will talk about it in another video. Our next video will be an important one because in that we will discuss extraocular movements and the actions of extraocular muscles. Till then, please like and share this video if you found it useful. And please subscribe to my channel to support free education. Thank you very much.